you have heavy rock where you have a mosh pit. The same thing happens when you go to, like, say, a grime or a drill show. It's a mosh pit, but everyone gets really like, oh my gosh, what they're doing. But it's the same music culture, just two different genres. So my name is Makeda Bennett-Amparbeng. I work part-time at British Underground, and I also have my own company called SDS Entertainment.
Makeda became a student at the commercial music course at the University of Westminster. And in the final year, students do what we call is a major project. And part of that project is to interface your work with the actual industry. And Makeda was able to secure an internship with British Underground. And so she was able to look at the project we're working on, which is Form 696, quite specifically look at the South London element of that. And this is everything from the South London artists to the South London community to clubs, what's happening around grime and Form 696. She then became a researcher on the project, interviewing individuals as part of the Wireless Festival component, and then became actually also the voice, because we needed a young voice. So she became the front in certain areas. She became the spokesperson for the project as well. These projects happened really quickly. We had to come out with a report within the time frame that worked for Ticketmaster and Live Nation as well. So on the back of the festival, we had to process all of that data quite quickly and then deliver. So we started the beginning of the year, so that would have been 2017, and the report was out by end of September 2017. And then the 696 was removed, I think, 2 weeks later.
My relationship with Form 696, it actually started out when I wanted to do my own events in Croydon. And I went to one of the venues that we had, and they said to me, in order to do like an urban night here, you have to hire more security, you have to do this, you'd have to get a Form 696. So that was the first time I ever heard of Form 696, so I thought, what on earth is this form that this person is telling me to fill out? Let me do a little bit of research. Form 696 was a risk assessment form that only only DJs and MCs performing to a backing track had to fill out 14 days before their event. A part of the form's process was you had high, medium, and low risk. So once you kind of put in your information, it would ask you for your name, your date of birth, where you live, all that kind of like personal information. And then it would then get sent off to the police, and the police would then risk assess your event saying high, medium, or low. It wasn't very clear what those terms meant. But if they then said, okay, we think your event is a high risk, they would then, 14 days before your event, would then cancel your event. If you put in a lot of money, you wouldn't get your money back, and you may not even get an answer as to why your event was cancelled in the beginning. So what I did was I took it to British Underground, where I also work, had a discussion with them there, and then from there we kind of then had conversations about the form with the Musicians Union, then went to UK Music and things like that. So my relationship with the form was more of, I saw something that just didn't make sense inside my head, and for my community, I saw it as a big issue that was had been around for many years and was having an impact and just needed to go, because I didn't feel like it served any purpose anymore.
One of the people that we work with, SDS Entertainment, Makeda, she was very much involved in helping to stop that happening. How could specific genres be targeted? Because you don't understand the people, the culture.
There was a lot of confusion in Vauxhall licensing, I think, between where the trouble or nuisance crowd was coming from, because it wasn't from the R&B events, it was from the house crowd. You go down Godin Street and it's full of nitrous oxide, N2O canisters, which was a big problem for littering and noise complaints, cars pulling up, playing loads of music. And police just assumed, because it's an urban crowd, it's related to R&B hip-hop bashment. But little did they know, it was coming from the Cutting Shapes deep house crowd. Maybe the police didn't understand house music had that kind of crowd following it. And the R&B lot were all on bottles of champagne and drinking alcohol.
In Croydon, the form had a slight impact, because it was a thing where people's licenses were being jeopardized if they didn't follow the rules of Form 696. You know, again, money was being, promoters' money was being lost. You could put in, let's say, like £10,000, let's say, into an event, and then a day before you can just get told, like, that your event's cancelled. You have no, you get no paperwork or anything like that to explain to you why your event was cancelled. I just think it stopped the growth of the scene for a while, I would say.
696 is a piece of legislation that could be applied to any musician. But what was clear was that they were disproportionately targeting black musicians. And it was quite vicious in that they could approach the artist, the promoter, or the club owner for information about the performance, and then pursue the artist or performer for details, which predominantly they'd pursue via the artist's mobile phone. And on occasions they would be going through the contact list and pursuing other individuals. So it's really intrusive, this. Most importantly, they prevent the artist from performing, on occasions threaten the landlord and or the promoter that they would not look favorably on renewing their license if they didn't comply. And by complying, you would give information about the artist.
From the club owner's perspective, they didn't want MCs because they associated MCs with Garage, and Garage coming up, even though it exploded commercially, it did have a lot of kind of association to trouble and stuff. But I think I mean, I'll never forget this. I remember going to an event, or loads of events actually, and the club owner, the bar owner sometimes would hide the microphone because they didn't want MCs over the music, because it's not the kind of, I don't know, it's not the vibe they wanted. But I never forget, I hosted an event in Kensington I was playing at, and it was a very plush bar. And I remember as the hours went on, like, the crowd started to show up, and I remember playing a song and pulling up the song, and the club manager or one of the club people come run up to me and said, no reloads in here, it's not that kind of club.
The police on occasions are looking at it as to who's potentially instigating unrest, public unrest. And that's normally the person up front on the mic. And it's the person delivering the lyrical content, the words. It's the person interfacing with the audience. So it could be the DJ, it could be the rapper, but it's the person up front. But the person up front is representing everyone behind. So you shut them down. You shut down the opportunity for everyone on stage.
I remember I was in Barbados, Oystins, and it was the Oystins Fish Festival, and there's a sound system, and all of these youths are just like making up some noise and just enjoying themselves. And I watched two police officers walk by, chilled. The night is hot. And that, to me, that was a point for me where I could see that cultural difference in our policing. And to do 696 when they did that, to actually focus on the grime events and all the rest. Why do you think, 21 seconds to go, you know, all those acts that could have been even bigger now and had to split off, because you just don't know how to manage people. And you don't understand the different cultures of people to be able to communicate on a level. Why should this genre of artists have to give their details and all the rest of it? You're either going to do that for everybody or not at all.
So for me, in terms of scrapping Form 696, the journey to scrap that form, it happened fairly quickly, but it still wasn't easy. The University of Westminster was involved, so Michael Riley was at a couple of meetings. You had Fergal Sharkey was at a couple of meetings because he had spoken about Form 696 a couple of years before. We had a couple of other universities that were involved and a couple of different other people that would come to the meetings for us to all discuss how do we go about removing Form 696. Pete Todd as well, he was involved. He played a key role in helping us remove the form. So it happened where we had numerous different meetings. All of us started talking about how do we get rid of the form? How do we, you know, what information do we need to find out?
I recognise there's a mountain to climb because this is law. This is the state. This is the police. And it's a policy that's live. And we approached it initially on the basis that it's shutting down black performers, and then quickly realised that we're not going to win the battle that way. We had to find another way. And that way was to do with supporting, it's an opposite approach, supporting what the state is saying. And the state was saying it supports the nighttime economy. It wants to promote club activities, performances, and all of that. So we reversed engineer and we looked for an access point. We found actually an advisor to the then head of digital and creative industries.
And that's when the mayor said he would like to review Form 696. So that was the first kind of big thing for us, where we got to review Form 696. Went to a couple of meetings with the Metropolitan Police. They kind of spoke to us about the form and told us the ins and outs of how the form is being used, and how they also kind of felt the form didn't really have any, didn't hold any weight anymore. A few of us went to Scotland Yard and spoke to the police, and that's then when we were kind of told that Form 696 would be scrapped, because it didn't hold any weight, and there was no need to have Form 696 anymore. So just through the different connects that we had, and just through pushing it up and up and up and just having that conversation, we managed to get the form scrapped.
But it's a load of work that made that happen. Makeda's part of that as our young representative. So she represented the voice of youth. And also it's a journey, if you like, from the community into higher education and coming out of higher education with a degree and saying, this is what I think. And it carries a different weight. So Makeda represents that.
So that was kind of the journey to really get rid of the form. And I'll still say, even up till now, it's still a thing of making sure that nothing replaces the form, and that the culture around the form is still something that we're all very much aware of, that there's still work to be done, let's say, to make sure that the scene is left alone.
So we're in a really interesting place now, where I think galleries, museums, artifacts, and I'm looking at Africa in this room predominantly, is right at the cusp of readjusting the historical narrative about creativity within a British context, black people of colour, what they've contributed. And that's an important position that we've arrived at.